kitchen tools to make cooking easier without the use of electricity, and that includes prep too. Would you be interested in using some of the tools that I use on a daily basis, if not weekly basis, to help make my plant-based Japanese cooking, as well as other types of cooking, as easy as possible? Stay tuned, because in this video I'm going to be talking about 15 plus of my favorite tools to do just that. And perhaps you can use some additions to your kitchen too. Let me know in the comments right now. She loves me. She loves me not. She loves me. She loves me not. She loves me. She loves me not. Chances are, if you love cooking like I do, you would also love some of the tools that would make your cooking, in terms of preparation, all the cutting, all the chopping, the slicing, all that stuff, as easy as possible. And if we haven't met before, my name is Pat Tokuyama. I'm the founder of All Day I Eat Like a Shark, this YouTube channel, as well as the Japanese Cooking Club, where I help people learn how to make plant-based Japanese food. If you would like to learn how to make plant-based Japanese food at home, subscribe to this channel for more plant-based Japanese cooking videos, or if you're ready to take the next step with more formal training in terms of cooking video lessons as well as recipes, make sure to check out the link in the description below for more information on the Japanese Cooking Club as well as my cookbooks. Hiya! 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 Clearly, I have never done karate or have been trained in any kind of formal martial arts like that, but I digress. So let's get back to what we're going to be talking about today with regard to our kitchen tools. The first thing that I wanted to talk about was the instruments that you're going to be using to cut your food. So I don't know why I called them instruments, but what I really wanted to say was knives. And so here I have my four core knives for what I use when I'm cooking, doing my prep. This is a Japanese chef's knife that my mom gave to me for college. Yes, I've had this thing since college. It still holds up pretty well. I don't use it as much as my Bob Kramer knife here. This is a knife that I got, I don't know, 4 or 5 years ago, roughly. This is the 8-inch version, and they have other different lengths depending on your preference, but this is my favorite knife out of all the different knives I've tried. I've tried probably about 5 or 6 different brands, but otherwise, this is my primary knife. This is my secondary backup knife. And if you're wondering what these holes are here, they're supposed to allow the food to release. So depending on what you're cutting, you may find that the vegetable tends to stick to the surface of the knife, but in my experience, the holes don't really seem to make a difference. Maybe you have had different experiences, and feel free to share in the comments if so. When I'm not using my chef's knife, I'm always using my little paring knives. These are the knives that Emmy likes to use instead of the chef's knives because they're smaller. She finds them a little bit, I guess, safer. I don't really know what brands these are, but I think these are 3.5 or 4 inches. So good for cutting fruits, small vegetables, peeling, things like that. So those are my four knives that I use on a most almost daily basis. And one of the things that you need to absolutely get if you don't have one of these is a hone. So this is a long metal rod, a stainless rod, with which you can straighten the edge of your knives. Cutting vegetables, meats, whatever you're using to cut, whatever it is that you're cutting, over time, it's gonna cause your blade to get crooked. So if you can imagine, when you're trying to cut something, you want your blade to be, you want it to have a sharp edge, and if it gets bent or, you know, crooked in whatever way, it's not gonna cut as efficiently as it could. And using a hone, going back and forth at an angle over the entire surface of the blade to hone and straighten the edge, you have to do it on both sides, so the top and the bottom, is going to straighten that edge. And you'll notice right away, especially if you haven't honed in a while, which you should be honing every day, but if you didn't do it every day, you'll notice right away that the blade will be able to cut much easier, much smoother than it had previously when it wasn't honed. Your knife is probably one of the most important tools in your kitchen, which is why we started with this one first. And you need to keep it sharp, because if you don't have a sharp knife, one, it's dangerous because you're gonna have to put more pressure to cut a vegetable, and two, it's not gonna make your vegetables look nice if you're going for a certain presentation, depending on how you're cutting your vegetables. One of the preferred methods of sharpening your knives is a stone, or a set of stones. So these are knife sharpening stones. This is the Wusthof brand. I think I'm pronouncing that correctly. This is three different stones, different coarseness levels. So first you're gonna be sharpening with a coarse, then you're gonna be sharpening with the medium, and then the fine. So the fine is more like a polish, and that's gonna help to give a very nice sharp edge to your knife. They use it 2 to 3 times a year, depending on how often I'm cooking, which is pretty often. That tends to keep my knives in tip-top shape, nice and sharp, along with my hone. A couple of very important things to have in addition to a good knife. And if you're in the market for a new knife, get something that's comfortable, easy to hold, not too heavy, or it is heavy, or if you prefer something that's heavy, get something that's heavier. And also consider getting stainless steel, which is the least maintenance, as opposed to carbon steel, which tends to rust if you don't take care of it. So now that you know what you need to keep your knives in sharp condition, the next most important thing I think is a cutting board. So I have a few of mine here, actually all of mine. These Epicurean are the oldest of the bunch. These are a composite of wood, so they are not natural wood. They're like a bunch of wood fibers or types of wood that have been pressed together. And what I liked about these is that they are thin, they're lightweight, and you can throw them in the dishwasher. They've held up pretty well over the years. I've had these probably around 5 years, roughly. You can tell they've been relatively scratched up. They're lightweight, and they are easy to handle. The bad thing is that they tend to warp. So if they get a little bit wet, they may slip around on your counter. They may, you know, be a little bit unstable, which can be dangerous. And if I were to be in the market for another cutting board, I might not get these again. And what I would get instead, hinoki. Hinoki is this wood here. It's a Japanese wood. It smells amazing. It's the same stuff that is used to make my tofu press or my tofu mold. If you want to check out that description. If you want to check out the product review for that, it smells amazing. There's nothing quite like it. It reminds me of the onsen in Japan. Some of the onsen are made with this, this type of wood, and so it smells very nice. It's very fragrant, but there are pros and cons. So one of the pros is that it's going to be a soft wood, so it's not going to dull your blades as quickly as something that's more firm or more hard. You do need to take a little bit more care of this. It does require it to be the surface is supposed to be wet a little bit beforehand, and it tends to stain if you didn't wash it or wet it properly. So you can see there's some stains here from some of the foods that I've cut on it. And it's a lot stabler, more stable than these cutting boards, which I like. It is a little bit thicker as well. A little bit more maintenance than these for sure. You can't throw this in the dishwasher. You have to hand wash it. And knowing the pros and cons, I decided to invest and try out this Hisoft cutting board. So this is completely synthetic product that is from Japan. You can actually get this on Amazon. I'll link it in the description below. And this has the benefits of being soft. So it's easier on your knives, just like the soft wood is easier. It's also easier in terms of the impact. If you're, you know, doing a lot of cutting or a lot of chopping, hitting something hard is gonna be a little bit harder on your wrist or your hand, as opposed to hitting or cutting on a softer surface. Also, this is much heavier. This is probably twice or three times as heavy as the wood boards. And it's also very sturdy, so it's not gonna warp. The only thing is that you have to hand wash this. You can't put it in the dishwasher, which is unlike that. And so far, so good. So this is probably what I would start with if you are looking for a brand new cutting board. So I'm curious, what kind of cutting boards do you use? Do you have a preference for the material? Have you tried any of these? What was your experience? Let us know in the comments below. Maybe we can learn from each other. We have here some Swiss Mar peelers. This is a three-piece set. There is a Julienne peeler. Regular peeler, and then I don't really know what this one is because I've never really used it. For the most part, I've had these for about 4 or 5 years, roughly. Next, we have microplanes. So depending on the type of cooking that you're doing, you may or may not need these. I use these primarily, probably 50% of the time, to zest citrus, like lime, orange, or lemon, and the other 50% of the time to grate cheese. Mostly, I use the coarse microplane, the fine one every now and then, but I would say probably 90% of the time is the coarse. And these are very sturdy, very well made. I throw these in the dishwasher, which probably isn't the best thing, but I do. Sometimes I hand wash them, and they have a nice rubber tip on the tip, and the handle is also rubber. So in case you want to put it onto your counter or your cutting board to grate, you can do that. So continuing on with our cutting tools, this is my mandolin. This is perfect. The perfect thing for slicing vegetables, making fries from potatoes. And I actually did a product review, if you want to check it out, to go in depth in terms of the pros and cons, what I use this for, what it would be good for. Key tool to have in your kitchen if you are going to be regularly slicing vegetables where you want a very thin slice. You want that precision, that accuracy. I use this pretty much almost all the time, maybe 70 to 80% of the time I'm making otsukemono when I want a very thin vegetable slice. Then I'll be using this mandolin. Oh yeah, and consider getting some protective gloves if you're concerned about cutting yourself either with a mandolin or with a microplane. They have some protective gloves that you can get on Amazon as well to protect your hands. Rounding out our cutting theme, we have some kitchen scissors here. These are KitchenAid brand. They're nice and sharp. They're very sturdy. They're very thick. You don't want some thin, flimsy scissors. You want a nice pair. These have like a rubber grip so they don't slip even if your hands are a little bit wet. And the good thing is that they're dedicated to food, so I don't need to worry about paper or packaging or tape or anything else that could potentially contaminate my food because it was used to cut something else that was not food. Recommend getting a dedicated pair of scissors like these KitchenAid ones specific to food. All right, so now you might be wondering what in the hell these two things are and why do I have two of them? Well, I do have two hands, but I wouldn't be able to use them twice, both at the same time, because they're garlic presses. So this is the first generation Rosli garlic press, and this is the second generation. I loved this one so much, I thought I would get the second generation one that was supposed to be new and improved because it has this a little function here to push off the garlic after it's pressed, as opposed to this one, which doesn't have that, so you have to cut it off or swipe it off. In my experience, the first generation is much more practical. So I would recommend, if you can still find this one, I don't know if they still sell it, the first generation, which looks like this. Crushing garlic is way better than mincing it or chopping it finely, and takes a lot less work. All you gotta do is squeeze. So now we are gonna be getting into my spatula collection. So you can see 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13 little ones, plus some big ones here. 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, and then a fish spatula, and then also a stainless spatula. So 21 total spatulas. Do I really need all of these spatulas? She asked, and I said, yeah, of course. Like when I'm cooking, I have to use one spatula per pot and per dish. And as you guys know, sometimes when I'm in the mood for cooking, I'm cooking like with all four burners going, maybe a few mixing bowls here and there, and the spatulas get used up very quickly. I decided to get more spatulas, and I really like the little spatulas because they're easy to hold. And they're not sticking out as much as these, which are good for maybe doing like a saute or a stir fry. But for the most part, day to day, I like the small, these are Tavolo brand. I think they're called, they have spatulas and they have like spoonulas. So the spoonulas have like a little indentation, like a spoon, so you can actually spoon stuff out. This is my little spatula collection. How many spatulas do you have? Let me know in the comments right now. And I guess since we're talking about spatulas, I actually prefer silicone and bamboo. If you noticed, I like the bamboo and the silicone because they are soft, so you don't have to worry about scratching any of your cookware. And the other thing that I like about the silicone and the bamboo is that it doesn't conduct heat like stainless. So if you are using something like a stainless utensil or a spatula, whatever, you may have to use a tea towel or a glove, a mitt, to protect your hand from the heat. So these are my ladles. I use these obviously for mostly soups and stews, curries, things like that, where there is more of a liquid factor or form that I'm dealing with. These are specifically for waffles that I got. These are supposed to be pre-measured, 1/3 cup and 1/2 cup, so you can just ladle your batter into the waffle machine and get a nice, perfectly shaped waffle every single time. But I use it for all kinds of different things. So here are two different whisks. I have a wire stainless whisk and a silicone smaller whisk. I use these mostly for sauces. Every now and then I use it for baking, but mostly for sauces. I don't use these as much as I initially did prior to when I got my electric immersion blender. I have two. One is silicone. This is a Kunrikon, I don't know if that's how you pronounce it. This one's silicone. And one of the things that I kind of should have paid more attention to was the reviews. On this one, some of the people said that the silicone tends to break off over time. And since it's been a couple years, the purple whisk wire has broken off a little bit. So what they said was true. Wire whisk, you don't have any issues because there's no silicone, but for this one, you might have some chipping off. And if you're wondering why I just have one chopstick, it's because my other one broke. I don't really remember what I was doing with it, but I only have one chopstick. This is a osaibashi, or it's a long chopstick that can be used for cooking or for serving. And this one's made of bamboo. If you are gonna be cooking a lot of Asian dishes, perhaps maybe this is something that you could try experimenting with. It does give you a little bit more versatility as compared to a spatula, because this is just gonna be able to turn your food, but this can actually mix it together, kind of like a fork. There's always the Western version, the tongs, the very practical and multi-purpose tongs. I have a couple pair. I have two right here. This is a larger version, stainless, and then this is a smaller Tavolo version. These are perfect for things like waffles, fish, meat, hambagu, anything that you would want to get a nice grip on and rotate or manipulate, whatever. And these are another important tool to have in your kitchen as well. Here, what we got are some strainers. These are colanders that I use for vegetables when I'm washing them, as well as fruit. I have a plastic one as well as a stainless one. This one I actually got specifically for steaming rice, sticky rice specifically, because that needs to be steamed. You can't put it in a rice cooker. And this is the size that would fit in my pot. So that's why I got that. I use this one mostly for making soy milk to remove the skins. And then these are my all clad set. This is my newest set. A little bit on the more pricey side, but definitely worth the investment. These are very well made. They're heavier on the handle side, which is kind of annoying if you ask me, because they are lopsided. If you're gonna be setting this on like a Pyrex to drain, it's gonna tip. So something to consider, but very well made. The wire mesh is very strong and I really like it. I would not get anything else other than this, knowing that. Grinders. So this is a salt grinder for coarsely flaked salt. And this is a pepper grinder. If you're not using freshly ground pepper in your cooking, you're probably missing out. Freshly ground pepper, especially using different types of peppercorns in combination, tends to elevate the flavor profile, the spiciness of your food, and it makes a big difference in terms of flavor and the aroma. Next up, actually, that I wanted to share with you are these olive oil pourers. So these are two dark glass bottles that I got for my olive oil. The reason why I got these was because I have a giant bag or a box of olive oil that I got on my last trip to Europe, and I needed some containers to put it in so it's easier to use. And the reason why you want olive oil in a dark container is because it tends to degrade when it's exposed to light. And the other thing that I was looking for was the little lid here. There's like a tiny little lid for the spout, which comes off as you tilt it. And then there's also a little air hole so that when you're pouring, air will go in and it'll allow the olive oil to come out. Also, the rim of the bottle is sealed, so it's not gonna leak anywhere. And overall, very happy with these, except for this one that's cracked. Very important, especially if you have some good quality EVOO, extra virgin olive oil. So chances are, if you enjoy cooking as much as I do, you probably enjoy using some of these tools that we talked about today. Let me know which one of these that you love the most. If you're gonna be buying any of these, let me know as well, I'd be curious. Because I know for me, they make my cooking much easier, especially since I have these tools at my disposal. Was there anything I missed? Let me know in the comments. Now you have a good idea of the tools that I use on a daily, if not weekly basis in terms of my cooking. These are the non-electric tools, and maybe in the next video, we'll be talking about some of the electric gadgets that help to make my cooking life just as easy. Whew. Good thing that wasn't a knife, because I would have just cut myself. And if you're wondering why we didn't talk about anything related to measuring or weighing, we talked about that in my video on baking tools and gadgets, so make sure to check that one out if you haven't. This is cracked. This is cracked. I just noticed that my bottle's cracked. I don't know how it happened, but it's cracked. So I probably shouldn't use this one. It's almost empty. So now I'm only gonna have one olive oil pourer, which is fine. I'll just have to buy another one. But anyways, and before you go, let me know if you like this video with a thumbs up. Leave any comments. If you have any feedback, if I missed anything, let me know in the comments below. And would you like to see a video on Japanese cooking tools as well? Let me know in the comments also. And in the meantime, check out this next video right here for something related to this video. This this video, I can't, having trouble speaking there, this video, or maybe even one about the electric cooking gadgets or the baking tools and equipment that I had mentioned previously. Jenna, bye bye. She loves me. She loves me not. She loves me. She loves me not. She loves me. She loves me not. She loves me. How about that?